stream. Our mouths are filled with laughter.
Our hearts sing with shouts of joy.
Worship the Lord of our salvation.
Worship the Lord.
Let us pray. God of dreams, you have done great things for your people. From times of old, you awakened the faithful to the dawn of your glory. Fill our mouths with laughter, loosen our tongues with shouts of joy. Anoint us with the oil of gladness, and make it known among all people that we will live as the oaks of righteousness and the plantings of the Lord. Amen.
Proclaim God's greatness everywhere, for God loves justice and hates wrong.
strong doing. God binds up the brokenhearted and comforts who's in despair. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God. Proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners. Proclaim comfort to those who mourn. Proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, God's righteousness for the poor, the outcast, the vulnerable. Proclaim the coming of hope in a tiny baby, the birth of righteousness and peace for all nations. Let us pray. Spirit of God, anoint us as messengers of your good news to all people. As we light this third Advent candle, move us to rejoice and to proclaim your greatness. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our scripture reading comes from the Gospel of John, the first chapter, verses 1, 6 through 8, and 19 through 28. Hear now God's word. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed, he did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not. Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." And then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of the one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent away from the Pharisees, and they asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan where John was baptizing. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's pray. Merciful God, we hear John's fervent cry, "Make straight the way of the Lord." But we don't always know what we should do. Our lives continue to carry on as they have before, and nothing seems to change. But we long to be messengers, to be beacons of light, to testify to Christ as the Lamb of God. Help us to walk in ways and live our lives as a testimony to Christ's love for each and every one of us and for the world. Amen. If I were to ask you, "Who are you?" how would you describe yourself to me? What would be the first thing that you would mention to me? Can you tell me? Who are you?
My name.
Tell me your name, okay. And then what would you tell me?
Wife,
mother, your roles, right?
Mm-hmm.
What you do. John didn't do any of that. Did you notice that? They asked him questions, and he said no. He told them who he was not. The same question asked over and over of John the Baptist by the religious leaders in Jerusalem helps us to see that we continue to live in a culture that is obsessed with self-actualization. We constantly feel the pressure to ask ourselves, "Is that really who I am? Is that how I define myself?" We are pressured into identifying ourselves by our jobs,
financial status, our family, our successes, our sex, our gender, our orientation, our appearance, and by what other people say about us. There are numerous ways in which we identify ourselves, but what happens when our identity changes? What happens when we experience failure or rejection, or we lose close family members or friends? We might find ourselves completely burned out. When our circumstances change, our identity and our sense of who we are can change as well. Someone whose identity is wrapped up in their spouse is going to have a difficult time when that spouse dies. So, who are you? What do you say about yourself? That's the question that's posed to John the Baptist. How John identified himself can help us find a reliable answer to this question. Who are you? You more than likely have had questions about people. The temple priest and those in charge in Jerusalem kept tabs on who was who and what they were doing. They were especially alerted if someone was behaving strangely and announced messages from God. That's why the questioning began. Who do you think you are? Calling people to repentance, baptizing all sorts of filthy sinners, John, prostitutes, tax agents, riffraff, and the lowlifes, as if they could just take a bath and be forgiven. Who are you, dressed in camel's hair and eating locusts and wild honey, hair all over, not shaven, calling us a brood of vipers and daring to call good, respectable, religious people to repentance? Who do you think you are, John? John had disciples of his own who followed him. Some thought John the Baptist would make a good Messiah. He was Messiah material, after all. But John knew who he was, and he knew who he was not. "I am not the Christ," he said. Some thought he was Elijah, who Malachi said would come to prepare the way of the Lord. But John would not tell them that he was. He said, "I am." Some thought that he was the prophet that Moses spoke about. Again, John denied it. "I am not the prophet." Even though he stood at the end of a long prophetic line, and he was a prophet of the truest sense of the word. Remember, Elizabeth was pregnant at the same time that Mary was. He came from a prophetic line. He was filled with the Holy Spirit in the womb. Remember when he leapt inside of Elizabeth's womb? In our text, John is described as not who he is, but the light that shines in the darkness. There were many answers that John could have given. He was a Nazarite. From the time that he was born, that means he never cut his hair, he never touched a dead body, he never drank wine. He lived a pure, physically uncontaminated life. He could have talked about his miraculous birth and how he was filled with the Holy Spirit before he was even born. He could have told them how he felt to live a life of solidarity and self-denial in the wilderness. He could have talked about his survival tactics, or perhaps his diet. He could have discussed his devotional routine, or he could have written a book about being a disciple of Jesus Christ and how to follow God. John didn't do any of that. Instead, John defined himself by his standards. He defines himself by their standards. Like John, we live in a world that seeks to define us by its standards, by your gender, your sex, your ethnicity, your class, your callings, and your vocation. But let me just tell you, your primary identity needs to be one that will not change. And it can encompass and give meaning to every part of your life. We shouldn't think that our jobs or our families or things of that nature are not important, but there is something of greater importance. Did you notice what John does? He refuses to define or describe himself by the world's standards, or even by his family, or his way of life, or his religious vows. His identity does not come from those things. John says, "I am not." And he invites you and I to do the same. With all of the "I am nots," John the Baptist does identify himself. John's answer is that he is getting people ready. He's preparing the way for someone else. "Who are you?" they ask. John's answer is this: a voice crying out in the wilderness, nothing more than a voice. John was a witness sent from God to testify, to point, to direct attention away from himself to the coming one. He was greater than John. He was not worthy to untie his sandals. The one who was Christ, the anointed one, the Messiah of God. He left it to Christ to give the religious leaders his identity. He was content to simply be a voice in the wilderness. John talks about who he is in connection to who Jesus is. How about you? Can you make a similar claim about your identity? Can you respond to who you are by talking about your relationship to God and Jesus Christ? Is your identity connected to Jesus? In the verse right after our text, John points to Jesus and says, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." We know who we are because we know whose we are. We belong to God because he has purchased us with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. God has shown all of us undeserving grace, an uncalled for generosity, simply because he loves us. Jesus is willing to offer his life so that your relationship and my relationship with God can be restored. All that has ever stood between us and God has been removed. No more separation from God. Your sin, your shame, your guilt, your failures, even death has all been removed. Christ, out of his great love, offers each and every one of us mercy because he offered himself fully to the point of death on a cross. You see, this grace and mercy that he gives you and I gives us the confidence to know that the worst in each one of us does not define us in God's eyes. What defines us in God's eyes is his love for you in Jesus Christ. Our identity is not located in our capabilities, in our family, our job, or anything that may change from day to day. Our identity is found in the loving grace and mercy of God. God who loves you. An identity grounded in God's mercy means that we think of who we are and who we need to see ourselves just like God sees us. Justified, forgiven, deeply, deeply loved. We no longer need to find our worth in external circumstances or places or people. God tells us who we are. We are shaped by our relationship with God and God's people. In Christ, we find our true self-worth and we become authentic. John, in the third Sunday of Advent, does not point to himself. Instead, he points to Jesus and says, "Behold, do you see him? Do you see him? It's the Lamb of God." Is there anything that separates us from God? Maybe there's something that is separating you from God. After all, we're all sinners. But that, my friends, is not the end of the story. I'm a sinner, but I am also forgiven and justified and redeemed because of God's unconditional love and grace. As Christians, we are people who have died with Christ. We have died with Christ in our baptism, and we have been lifted up and renewed. We are born anew through Jesus Christ, who has given us the power of the Holy Spirit and transforms us into his image. Because of Christ's redemptive work on the cross, Jesus is the very Lamb of God who took each and every one of our sins away. We're no longer defined by the things that are here today and gone tomorrow. Our identity is in Jesus, the Lamb of God, the light of the world. To proclaim Christ does not mean that we are reprogrammed or we become street evangelists. It's like the hymn says, they will know we are Christians by our love. And that is how we proclaim Jesus. We get up and we gather as the body of Christ. We draw strength from studying scripture and hearing God's word proclaimed in the sermon. We worship, we refocus, and we have a purpose. We build our confidence and we encourage one another to take Christ back into the world and fearlessly witness his love. It is within the walls of our church that we gather the strength, but it's outside the walls, in the world, that we must spend our strength for God's glory. Will you proclaim hope? Will you find peace that's been given? Will you experience joy in your hearts and your lives? And will you let the love of Jesus Christ seep out so that everyone knows that love? Amen.
Thank you.
You are anointed to be Christ's messenger, a voice in the wilderness, a light to show the way. Go and be the voice and be the light.